As this is now our third lesson as we study in this shack study. And today's message is dealing with trusting God's promise. And one of the scriptures that we want to use, if you will, Daniel, is Hebrews chapter 13 and verse number 5. And that verse comes from the New International Version. And the word simply says, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." And if we have been watching for the past couple of weeks, and if you saw the movie, and it was amazing how this week's lesson, the clip that was provided, didn't really provide, I think, if you will, allow me to use this vernacular, the juice that it needed to be able to present to you this morning. So I thought I could, you know, get a head start and said, call Deaconess Rell, order me the DVD. I mean, the figure's got to be out on the DVD. Back ain't out on the DVD. So I found a way to be able to watch the entire movie again. And matter of fact, I was able to allow my mother and my mother-in-law to watch it. But I got to the point where I needed to see so I could be able to clearly explain things to you. But if we've been watching and we've seen the struggles that the character Mac was going through, and the anxiety and the doubt that he's had, we can attest to the fact that it's easy for each and every one of us to become overwhelmed with pain and the circumstances of life. And one thing I've discovered, beloved, that pain, Deacon Farrell, has a way of twisting us inside out and making us do unthinkable things. And what Candace, I'm discovering in life is that, and I got this morning, I was listening to Bishop Bronner, and a lot of times the pain that we experience in our lives is because we have no peace in our lives. And we have to understand something, beloved, if you don't have anything in life, you have to have peace. I'm not talking about just being mere happy, because to be merely happy means that something good is happening to you. But when things around you, Elder Wondricks, aren't all that great, you still have to have peace. I said this time and time again, even when I was on the night shift before I got this new job, there was one thing that I always looked forward to. Even when I left my home at night and I closed the door, I knew that, God, if you can just get me back to 2775 Parcel Road, I know that in this place where my wife and my children abide, there is peace. And a lot of times I found out, Candace, that the reason why some people don't want to go home is why? Because there's no peace in their home. The reason why there's so many struggles and so many pains in relationships is because that the one of the two partners there, listen, first of all, you can't have peace with somebody else if that person don't have peace with themselves.
That's right.
Help me somebody.
Amen.
They look to find everything wrong with somebody else when they have not found the peace in their own lives. And here it is, because of that peace that lacks in their lives, now the pain and the struggle that you're experiencing are coming from somebody that don't have their own peace. But you got to understand, beloved, whether or not somebody's in your life that don't have peace, first of all, they don't need to be in your life if you can't have peace with them. You do better all by yourself. Amen, somebody. Talk to me this morning. But if you're going to have somebody, that's why, and this ain't part of the lesson, I need to talk to somebody. That's why we have to be evenly yoked with those individuals that are in our lives.
That's right.
Amen. Just because she looks good don't mean that she's good for you, fellas. Ladies, just because he got all the muscles and the six packs does not mean that he is the one for you.
Amen.
But you have to have peace with that person. Listen, because first of all, when we talk about marriage, I believe is for a lifetime.
Amen.
Amen. And I ain't got time to spend my life with somebody where I'm not going to have peace. So many folks struggling. Amen. Because, you know, they just in it, you know, because of the children. No! I want to have peace. My wife said all the time, if nothing else goes on in our house, she said, we're going to have peace in our house. And I thank God for my wife because she don't take no tea for the fever when it comes to her house. I don't care what goes on. I don't care what the children are dealing with. They bring it in the house. She said, hold up, leave it outside because there's peace in this house.
Amen.
All right.
Amen.
I hear you.
Amen. So you know what? I can't help Jordan but to fall in line. And I've discovered, Deacon Pharrell, that it works.
That's right.
Amen. She'll tell me, hey, don't bring that in here. Don't bring it. I don't enough. And you got to put up your you got to put up the hand. I don't want to hear it.
Amen.
Stop allowing yourself to be a dumping ground for somebody else's garbage. Because the enemy is trying to steal your peace and to steal your joy.
Amen.
Amen. But you gotta, when we talk about pain, we talk about pains, you gotta understand something, beloved, that the secrets that we keep have a way of clawing themselves to the surface. See, here it is, we got a lot of things on the inside that we keep bottled up. And if we don't deal with them, here's the thing. We don't deal with the pains and the hurts that we have experienced in our life. When we look at this movie, there were a lot of things that were going on in McKenzie's life that he never dealt with in his past. So now he took the past and bring it into the future. And you got to know and understand that the past is there for a reason, to stay in the past. But when you try to bring it into your future life, it's going to mess everything up. Are you understanding me this morning? So the pain, the secrets, beloved, we understand they're real and they're powerful. And they threaten us. And perhaps even more powerful than our outward circumstances are the fears and secrets that pollutes our minds and our hearts. We got to get rid of those pains. We got to get rid of those secrets. Okay? Amen. We can try to bury our pain. But when you avoid, here it is, Candace, when you avoid dealing with the healing from it, it almost haunts us. If you don't deal with the pains of your past, they can continue. They're always coming up in your mind. Always coming up in your mind. That's why we have to learn how to do what we have to learn how to deal with it. So let me help you. Let me help you just set the stage for you real quick. And part of the movie, those of you who seen the movie, and if you haven't seen it, I'm sorry, I'm spoiling it for you. And part of the movie, have you seen The Shack? I'm sorry, you're about to get the bills up. We know that McKenzie, or Mac, as a child, he was being abused by his father, who was an elder in the church. And if you remember how it was when they called the invitation to discipleship, Mac, at a young age, he couldn't take it any longer from seeing his mother being abused, from seeing him being abused, and he went and he told the preacher. Yeah. And the father got angry. He said, you embarrassed me in front of my folk. But he told him, he said, listen, I can't take this no more. And the father beat him, and watch this. Did y'all pay attention? He beat him, making him scream out scripture. So many times there are people that we've experienced coming up that beat us with the word of God. And we wonder why we can't get people to come back to the house of God. Help me somebody. So, he's a grown adult and he's in church. Y'all stay with me. You remember when he's in church and they're singing? They're singing the hymns, and Mac is, everybody's singing, his little baby girl. She's singing, everybody's singing. Mac looking around like, really? What they singing about? What is there to be singing about? They show for a brief moment. Remember the stained glass window with the nails in the hand? And they show this, and it makes me wonder, why is it that, here it is, sometimes we can't get people to come to church. But if we get them to come to church, Deaconess Pharrell, we get those same kind of individuals that's looking around wondering, what are they doing? What are they singing about? Amen. And here's the thing, beloved. If you're that type of person, when you're coming and you're wondering why it is, you can't allow your past to hinder you from receiving the blessing that God has for you today. Amen. Too often times we miss what God has for us because we're so hooked on what things have taken place to us in the past. And let's be truthful. We done been to some churches, man, I tell you what. I remember some faces. I ain't gonna call no names because my mother and my mother-in-law here, and they gonna know who I'm talking about. But I remember some faces, some of them old saints. They were kind of rough.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. But they call themselves doing it in the name of the Lord.
The Lord. Yes,
y'all, y'all don't know what I'm talking about. Amen. And if we had succumb to their type of traditional religion, amen, we ourselves might be one of those ones that might not want to come back to church anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. But I thank God, amen, that there was a way of receiving the truth of the Word of God.
Yes.
And that's what the world is looking for. They're looking for the truth. Amen. Stop this. Listen, stop trying to beat up somebody.
Amen.
Amen. The songwriter says, sweep around your own front door before you try to sweep around mine. Amen.
Amen.
Look at your own self in the mirror. Let that word hit you. Let that word transform you before you try to let it transform somebody else. So, let's set the scene. I know I'm kind of ahead of myself, so I'm just going to go to that second clip. Just give me a minute. So, here's the scene. Mac, he goes to the barn, or the workshop, if you will, that Jesus is working in. And Jesus says to Mac, he says, if you're up for a walk, there's something on the far side of the lake I'd like to show you. Now, there is a boat tied to a dock, all right, in the water. And Jesus says he has some work to finish up in the shop. And he tells Mac, he said, go ahead on ahead, get in the boat.
Yeah.
Meet me on the other side. He said, matter of fact, I left a fishing pole in the boat for you so you can do some fishing on your way across the lake, all right? So Mac, he gets in the boat. And it appears to be that he rolls out, and I'm setting this up for you because this is not in the clip, but he rolls out into the middle of the lake, and it's real nice, peaceful, and calm. And in the midst of the calmness, Mac hears a voice, Daddy! And he looks, and he sees his son in the water. Now, if you remember, the boat had capsized when they were at the campground, right?
That's right.
And the son fell in, the daughter fell in. So now he's hearing these voices. Remind you, he has not dealt with the past.
Yeah.
He's still dealing, he still has the pain of his past, even in the present situation. All right? It comes back to haunt him.
Mm.
He looks in the water, he sees his son in the water, and from natural instinct, Deacon Farrell, he reaches out to grab a hold of the vision that he sees. But when he grabs out to reach a hold of the vision that he sees, when he brings his hand up, I don't know what this means in the movie, but his hand is filled with a black or oily substance. And I perceive that to be a dark place where he was in his life. Come on.
Mac, it's okay.
Why are you doing this to me?
This isn't me.
You told me to come out here.
Mac, this is happening inside you. You're letting it consume you. You don't have to. Just take a deep breath and listen to my voice.
Play it again. That's all you get. Play it again. Run it. That's all you get. Really?
Mac, it's okay.
Why are you doing this to me?
This isn't me.
You told me to come out here.
Mac, this is happening inside you. You're letting it consume you. You don't have to. Just take a deep breath and listen to my voice.
What was the first thing that Mac said out of his mouth when he found himself in trouble? Y'all talk to me. Tell the same. There you go. You ain't got to be afraid. Why are you doing this to me? He says, you told me to come out here. Why are you doing this to me? The question is, Danette, how many times have we experienced pain in our life that we ask God the question, why are you doing this to me? We try to blame God. You told me to be here. I wouldn't be here if you didn't tell me to be here. So it's your fault. What did Jesus say? It's not me. It's you. This is happening on the inside of you. Preach, Holy Spirit. And until you personally deal with the stuff on the inside of you, that's what's going to happen. And you're going to continue to try to blame God. And God is saying it's not him. You yourself have to deal with your inner pains and your inner circumstances. The first thing I want you to see, Daniel, first point I want to make is talking about going under. Going under. Let me ask you a question. For those of us that still can get on a bicycle and ride it without falling off or tipping over, you remember how it was if you ride a bicycle in that, and if you saw a pothole or a rock in front of you, that you would avoid it. But notice something. If you saw that rock or that pothole in front of you, and if you continue to look at it, no matter how much you knew you needed to avoid it, if you continue to look at that rock or that pothole, you're going to end up running into that rock or that pothole. Because why? You kept looking at it. You kept focusing on that rock or that pothole. All right? Even if you intended, your intent of focus is to avoid something that's in the way, focusing on it causes you to head directly towards it. Beloved, the more you focus on the rising water, the more powerful it becomes and deeper you begin to sink. The more you focus on the things of your past, the more those things continue to rise up in your life and cause you to sink, all right? Those of us that have seen the movie, we know that, and I talked about it, the history that Mac had and the hurt that it had. And to be fair about it, he's experienced some awful tragedies. On top of, he experienced the tragedy of his past, of his youth, now he just lost his baby girl. He's gone through a lot. But his way, watch this, his way of dealing with things is not to deal with things. And how many of us do the same thing? Amen. The way we deal with stuff is if we don't deal with it. We think that it's just going to go away. And you got to understand something, beloved, the struggles and the shame and the hurts that we just keep stuffing them down and we try to avoid them. It just makes things more disastrous. They have a way of finding a way to the surface and forcing their way out. All right? And we got to understand, we got to deal with issues. We have to deal with issues. Things that are going on in our family, we can't just keep tiptoeing and walking around stuff. And things are going, you know, some people, Elder Wanderers have the philosophy of some things are better left unsaid. Well, you know what? How many times are you going to say some things are better left unsaid? Until they keep building up and guess eventually, they're going to come out. And they're going to come out in a wrong way and in a hurtful way. Are you understanding me this morning? So we have to learn how to. We have to learn how to deal with things. But we also got to remember God's promises. His promises say, I will never leave you, nor what? Forsake you. Are you hearing me this morning? And a lot of times we want to blame God. But God has nothing to do with it. He says, I will never leave you, nor forsake you. It's not him that has distanced himself from us. It's us that has distanced ourselves from him. See, we want to blame Jesus just like Matt wanted to blame Jesus. But Jesus said, it's not me. This is happening on the inside of you. You're letting it consume you. And you don't have to. That's the thing. We don't have to let it consume us. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. He said, why? For my yoke is easy and my burdens are light. The songwriter used to say, give it to me, I'll share it. Give it to me, I'll bear it. If there's a need in your life, the song says, I will take it if you only give it to me. So the question is, how do we get there? How do we experience more than why are you doing this to me type thing? All right, here's the second thing I want you to look at. And it's plainly says, look at me. Jesus says, look at me, look at me. What does it say? He said when Mac was in despair, the first thing Jesus said, what? Look at me. Jesus says to Mac, look at me. He says, just take a deep breath and listen to what? My voice. Just keep your eyes on me. I'm not going anywhere. That's real simple. That's real simple. Take a deep breath. How many times we just get in a panic situation? Breathe. Take a deep breath. And if you listen, when you watch again, and Matt, when he started to listen to Jesus' voice, here's the thing. You got to learn how to listen.
Amen.
Listen to what Jesus is telling you. He says, take a deep breath. And, Jesus said, that's it. Breathe. Just relax. Keep your eyes off of me. Keep your eyes on me. Stop looking at what's going on around you, because that's not me. The trouble, the pain you're experiencing, I'm not trying to bring you pain. You're bringing your own pain on yourself. Mm-hmm. Listen to me. Listen to my voice.
Yes,
I'm not going anywhere. Okay. Pastor, okay, I hear you. But this is fictional, man. This is a movie. This is a movie, all right? What I'm experiencing, Pastor, this is real life stuff. This ain't up on the big screen. This is happening in my life. Sometimes in slow motion. Have you ever had stuff happen in your life and seem like it's going in slow motion? You see stuff, what was that, everybody see Groundhog Day? Y'all ever see that movie? Every day, the same thing happening over and over and over again. Have you ever gone through that in your life and it seemed like it just don't end? I know y'all got great lives, I understand. I'm just talking to some real folk. I just want to talk to some real folk this morning. But I want to help you out with the Word of God. Here's the antidote, straight from the Word of God. Look at John chapter 16 and verse 33. John 16 and verse 33, and the Word of God says, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have what? Peace. Help me, Daniel. You may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Amen. Amen. He says, and I talked about this earlier. He said that in me you will have what?
Peace.
Amen. That's what Jesus said. That's what we need. Peace. Amen. You need peace with all the chaos. He said, because in the world you're going to have tribulation. Be of good cheer, for I will overcome the world. In this world, you need peace.
Yes. Peace.
When's the last time you looked at the news? Sister, brother, you need peace.
Amen.
Stop worrying about what the White House is doing. Stop worrying about what the FBI is doing. You need peace.
Amen.
Stop worrying about if we're going to go to war in Russia or North China, North Korea, whoever, whatever. You need peace. In this world, you need peace. Psalms 46, verse 1 through 3, and this is from the Good News Translation. God is our shelter and strength, always ready to help in times of trouble. Y'all see this? So we will not be afraid, even if the earth is shaken and mountains fall into the ocean's depth. Even if the seas roar and rage and the hills are shaken by violence.
Yes.
The psalmist says, listen, in the time of trouble, I know you're right there with me. Even when all these things are going on around me. He says, I know you are right there. I don't have no need to be afraid. In John chapter 14 and verse 27. John 14 and 27, the word says, I am leaving you with a gift. Peace of mind and heart. Y'all see this? The word continuously tells us this, beloved. Trust in this promise. He wants to give you and I peace. You don't need to struggle. You don't need to go through the pain that you're going through. Give it to him. He wants you to have peace. And the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid.
Amen.
Y'all see this?
Yes, Lord.
My mother used to sing a song. I don't know. There's one song she could sing and she did that fairly well. The song says, she laughing, she knows she don't want to talk. The song says, this joy I have.
Yes.
The world didn't give it to me. The world didn't give it, and what the world can't what take it away.
Amen.
Amen. So you got to understand it, beloved. You got to have a song and a joy in your heart, and the Word of God letting you know the joy that I have and the peace that I have, it comes from God.
Amen.
I don't have to deal with the pain. I don't have to deal with the struggle. Yes, I need to acknowledge it. I need to get it out of my life. But this is God's peace that he wants to leave with me.
Amen.
Life is too short.
Yes,
for us to go through life without having peace. I got some seasoned folk in the house that can attest to the fact that they're, listen, I'm a young cat. I'm a young buck, amen. And I've gotten this thing, I believe I'm getting this thing down, Deacon Pharrell, about having peace.
Amen.
Amen. Does that mean you're gonna not gonna have struggles? No. Jesus just told you you're gonna have them. But he just says, I'm leaving you a gift. I'm leaving you a gift. Peace of mind. Phew. Goodness gracious. Peace of mind. Do you know what it is to have a peace of mind? You got folk that go to sleep with all kind of anxiety. They wake up with the same anxiety. They don't have a peace of mind. You ever have those kind of people? You know, some of you know what I'm talking about. You go to sleep and your mind just keep racing. It happens to me sometimes. Mm-hmm. It happens to me sometimes. I'll be honest with you. But God said, man, go to sleep.
Amen.
Watch this. The word of God, mom says, he neither slumbers nor sleeps. So if he's awake, why do I need to be awake?
That's right.
Makes no sense.
That's right.
If he's going to stay up all night, if his angels have an assignment to stay up all night,
yes.
I need to get a good night rest.
Yes.
So you know what I've been doing, big fella? I got my daughter bought me one of those, what's the thing you bought me? It's a knockoff, what's the thing? Fitbit. And on this Fitbit, I can monitor my sleep. So you know what I've been doing? To make sure, Jordan, I've been getting a good night's sleep, I put that thing on at night, hit the sleep button, and then when I get up in the morning, it's been telling me for the past couple of days, oh, you got a good night's sleep. I woke up this morning, looked at the thing, and said, I got 10 hours of sleep last night. I said, hallelujah. Peace of mind.
Amen.
How many of you can go to sleep and sleep 10 hours peacefully? And it tells me whether I slept heavily, it tells me whether I slept lightly, tell me how many hours I slept light, tell me how many hours I slept heavy. I say, ooh, I like this. But you can't do that if you don't have what? Peace of mind. Goes back to what we said, you gotta trust God's promises. You gotta trust his promises, all right? So, the promises that God gives us, they're powerful promises. And these words and these scriptures that I'm giving you, they help to sustain us, beloved. God is calling us in these scriptures as plainly as Jesus is calling Mac in that movie. And his words to us convey the same message. Just take a deep breath and listen to his voice. Listen to his voice. All right? So here it is. We talked about going under. We don't want to go under. Then we want to look at him. And then lastly, here's the last point. Beyond the boat. You got to get beyond the boat. Now, I don't want to take for granted that everybody knows the scripture. That's a terrible mistake for any pastor or any teacher to make, to think that people know the scriptures. All right? So I'm not going to take that for granted. You may have heard it. All right? You may have read it. You may have read it today, but I'm going to show it to you again today. In Matthew chapter 14, verse 22, a familiar verse of scripture, but we're going to go there this morning from the New International Version. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. Sound familiar? After he dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone. And the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it is I, don't be afraid. Lord, if it is you, Peter replied, tell me to come to you on the water. Come, he said. Then Jesus got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind and he was afraid and beginning to sink, cried out, Lord, save me. Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and called him. You of little faith, he said, why did you doubt? Now, in this event, the disciples' storm was an external storm. Okay? But some of the things that you are dealing with in your life is not external, but it's internal. All right? But whether your storm is external or internal, the solution is just that, that you have to keep your eye on Jesus. The reason Peter began to sink is he took his eyes off of Jesus. The reason that in the picture, McKenzie was going through things in his life, he never had his eyes on Jesus. All right? But you have to keep your eyes on him. But the real part, Deacon Estrell, that I love about this movie, that it's not in this clip, is that after McKenzie breathed, after he kept his eyes on Jesus, if you notice how the darkness of the water began to subside, how the late begot came calm, what Jesus said, come on, take a walk with me. Y'all remember that? Max said, I can't do that. Jesus says, you're right, you can't. Without me, you can't do it. Candace, what he was saying is, the situation that had you in turmoil, you don't have to let it take you under. Matter of fact, you can walk above it. Y'all don't want to hear this morning. And the only way, Deacon Ferrell, that you can walk above it and walk on it is with Jesus right by your side. Help me somebody. So here it was that Matt got out of himself. He got out of the pain that he was experiencing himself and began to walk with Jesus in peace and in comfort. Matter of fact, in the movie, it showed him running across the lake. Man, can you imagine that? Walking hand in hand, walking, running with Jesus across the problems that you thought had you down. But it's the promises that God made to you and to I. He said, I will do what? I'll never leave you nor forsake you. That's the lesson today. Don't let whatever it is in your life consume you, the pain that you're going through. And it's amazing how God has given us these series of messages because it's for this house, for this season. Yes. Many of you are going through some pains and some struggles. Yes. That for whatever reason that you don't want to divulge to anybody, not even to your spouses, but God wants you to be released from it today. He wants you to be free. He wants you to have a peace of mind. He wants you to have a peace of heart. Amen. He don't want you to continue to struggle the way you're struggling because it's not him. He's not doing it to you, but you're doing it to yourself. So today is your day of release. Amen. And you need to get it today while you're in this place. Amen. Yes. A release is in the house and he wants you to have peace. Don't walk out of it. It's raining on the outside, but I guarantee you when you go out, you're going to feel the warmth and the comfort of the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because you received his peace in his house today. When you walk into your house, you're going to have peace. When you walk into that job of tomorrow, you're going to have peace. Why? Because you're going to release it all to him in his house today. You're going to trust in his promises.